It just had to have been amazing to wake up in your tent or outside under the stars and hear this just wailing guitar to rise and shine to and kind of draw everybody together at the stage.
You're listening to the Simple Camping Podcast. This is where we'll explore the joys, sorrows, and adventures of camping in the great outdoors through editorials, interviews, and of course, stories.
Hey campers, Mark here from OverlandTrailer.com, and this week's podcast is coming from inside a yet-to-be-finished teardrop trailer. If you check out this podcast on YouTube, you can see the shell, basically, of this teardrop trailer that will probably be going out in the next couple of weeks. So pretty exciting there. This week's podcast is basically peanut butter and jam. It's two things that were made to go together so perfectly, which is camping and music. And it was inspired by somebody who rented a trailer from us and a conversation I had with him after he returned. But first, I want to remind you that our full-length feature documentary is now online completely for free. All you have to do is go to our website, overlandtrailer.com, and join the 58 Club membership, which is also free, and you can see it there completely for free. Of course, you can still buy it from Amazon, who was originally the publisher for this, but why give them money? Let's not do that. Just come and we'll give it to you for nothing. So I had this renter come back and he returned his trailer. And as I was going through the check sheet of things that I always check to make sure that the trailer comes back in good shape, I asked him, how was your trip? And he said, well, it was okay. And it didn't sound like he was super excited about it. So I kind of dug a little bit more and I said, so what, you know, what was great, what wasn't great? And he ended up telling me that he wanted to recreate an experience he had as a child for his own children that he had taken along on this trip. And it didn't work out because of the other families that they were camping with. He grew up very much like I did, with musical instruments around the campfire. That didn't necessarily mean that we did singing, but it was always, you know, somebody picking on a guitar or there were banjos, mandolins, all sorts of things. And so he took his guitar on this camping trip, hoping to recreate that experience for his kids. However, the other families that were there, they were all sitting around the fire, but everybody, he said, including the other kids, were sitting there on some sort of electronic device, looking at the screen and playing games and that sort of thing. And he was bummed out because he couldn't recreate this memory that he had for his own kids. And I told him, I was like, well, you can try again, just go with some different people. And he said he might do that. And then I asked him, like, what songs did he sing or what songs did he play that were, you know, steeped in his memory for so long? And he told me a lot of the historic ones, Yankee Doodle and stuff like that. And then he asked me, have you ever looked at the lyrics to kids' camp songs? And honestly, I don't think I have. I mean, I grew up singing kids' camp songs occasionally, but I never really looked at those. And he said, you should look at it. It's hilarious. And so, inspired by our lovely customer today, occasionally this podcast will be broken up into little recitations of these lyrics from kids' camp songs that date all the way back to the 1800s. I'm not making these lyrics up. They are real, historic, and really twisted and dark, usually. To keep you from wondering, like, did I suddenly, you know, just like switch personalities, I'll play a sound first that'll sound like this, and that will let you know that I'm going to recite one of these lyrics. And when that is done, you'll hear, and then after that, we will return to our regular, like, scheduled podcast. And to make this a bit smoother, this podcast actually has five different parts. I'll just be playing one of these lyric videos after each part of this podcast. In discussing things with him about these historic songs, he said, have you ever read children's poetry? Which, weirdly enough, I have, partially because I used to be an educator, and so he asked me, he's like, what do you know about them? And I thought about it for a second. I was like, yeah, a lot of kids' poetry and children's literature is really dark and twisted, that old stuff. Ring Around the Rosie, Pockets Full of Posies, Ashes, Ashes, We All Fall Down, that is a fun little kid's song, but really it's describing the symptoms of the Black Plague right before death occurs. It's not really a children's topic, and yet we've turned it into this kid's game. And he had a very good point. And so that's what got me digging into these kids' camp songs, and they are priceless. You will enjoy them. So as we sat there and talked about this, I told him about a camping experience I had where I had gone out by myself camping because the family was out of town. And what am I going to do on a weekend by myself? Obviously, I'm going to go camping. And so I grabbed my teardrop trailer and I packed it up and I threw in my little battery powered amplifier, which I love. And I told him about it too. I'll actually put a link in the show notes for this podcast in case you're a musician and you want to take a small battery powered amplifier, runs on AA's or you can plug it in. And it also has a headphone jack, so you don't have to annoy all your neighbors in your campground. So I took that amplifier and I took my cigar box guitar, which I made out of leftover parts from building these teardrop trailers. Here's a top secret that I'll let you in on. The theme song that is played for this very podcast was made on a guitar that I made. It's a license plate guitar that is the license plate on the very first trailer that we made at Overland Trailer, and it's also made with parts that we took off of that first trailer because we were prototyping a whole bunch of different things on it. So that song that you hear was actually made on this guitar. So as I said, I loaded the amplifier and the cigar box guitar into the trailer and I headed out and camped. And that night, sitting around the campfire by myself, I just sat there and like plinked away on the thing and looked at the stars and looked at the moon, and it was just like a really great way to spend an evening. And so as we discussed this, we both just decided, yeah, we should go camping together sometime. So maybe that's the solution. This guy has similar memories to me. Maybe we should just go camping together. So we may work that out. We'll see what actually happens. So that's the end of part one. On to part two. I'm squishing up a baby bumblebee. Won't my mommy be so proud of me? I'm squishing up a baby bumblebee. Ew, what a mess. Now, part two, I thought I would go back in history, not too far, but, you know, 150 years or so, and look at camping and look at music. The cowboy era with these guys driving cattle from Texas up to the railroad lines, all the way up as far even as Chicago, that era in American folklore seems to have lasted for decades to most people. And it's probably just because of, you know, Zane Grey and the other authors who write Westerns, or John Wayne and his Westerns, or just the Hollywood experience of the Westerns. The cowboy experience really didn't last that long. It was a few years before the farmers in those areas who didn't like the cows coming across their fields put up a brand new invention known as barbed wire, and they could no longer do the cattle drives. But in the early days, these cowboys would go out and they would drive their cattle to market. They would stop in the evenings and they'd make their food over a fire, usually with some sort of Dutch oven. They had some really messed up recipes. You can find some on our website. It's kind of entertaining. And they would talk. They would share outlandish stories. But there was also singing involved. And a lot of the songs that we have in our folk sort of genre came from were influenced by the cowboy era, which was influenced by the Civil War era, and there was a whole set of songs that went with that too. People sitting around, what are you going to do in your spare time in the evening? You have to watch the cows, you have to watch your horses, you have to watch out for, you know, people who don't want you on their land. What are you going to do to pass the time? Well, you're going to sing and you're going to play whatever instrument you have, or you're going to make an instrument, you know, like a diddly bow out of a broomstick and a little box. I mean, you do what you can to just kind of pass the time, entertain yourself, and maybe along the way you happily discover something that will become part of American folklore. So that is really kind of where the first images, these romantic images of music and camping, start to merge in the American psyche. So that's the end of part two. The tiniest worm I ever saw was stuck inside my soda straw. I coughed him up and he was dead. I put him in my camper's bed. So part three, I was thinking about these cowboys sitting out by the fire with their cows and moving from place to place and singing these songs in different places and how their music would spread from town to town to town. And it made me think, like, that's not actually too far off from, like, modern day musicians. They do tours. They may fly, they may ride in a bus, they may walk. I mean, it depends on their income level and how, you know, their music and all of that. But musicians travel from place to place, and a lot of musicians travel in RVs. A lot of them, even full-time, live in RVs. And so I got to thinking, like, what musicians out there maybe had been inspired by nature and camping in their music? And so I did some research. The list is very long, but I'll give you a couple of people who are probably the best known in their music and in their genre for probably being the best campers and musicians. So here's the list. Johnny Cash, the Beach Boys, Jack Johnson, the Eagles, John Denver, Miley Cyrus, Dave Matthews, the Beatles, Will.i.am, the Black Eyed Peas in general, really. All inspired by nature or by camping, and it shows up in their music, and especially fits some of those genres pretty well. Like Johnny Cash, I think, you know, like, of course, that's camping music. It just makes sense. What's interesting, too, is these musicians live in these RVs full-time, so they're almost like full-time campers for most of a year while they're touring around from place to place where they, perform their craft. So you have people writing music who are essentially full-time campers in these very famous musicians who show up on The Tonight Show and stages and arenas and outdoor music festivals. That's the end of part three. Honk, honk went the Big Mac truck one day. Split, splat went the little green frog. And his eyes don't go mwah anymore, cause they got eaten up by a dog. Ruff, ruff. Now here in part four, I really keyed in on the outdoor music festival, because that is usually where you'll find the artists living in their RVs, as I mentioned in part three. But you'll also find the people going to listen to them, their audience, also camping for maybe an entire weekend to hear a number of artists who are there for an outdoor music festival. And I've been to a number of these, but the one that comes to mind and is probably the most memorable, the one that floats to the top, is a blues festival that I attended in George, Washington, which is a town, not the guy. So George, comma, Washington, that's a place. And the amphitheater is in the gorge of Washington State. So you sit on this hillside and you look down to basically the top of a cliff that drops off into a dry river valley. And it's beautiful, it's hot, it's dry, there's no trees to ruin the view anywhere. It's out in the desert of Washington. At this blues festival, the headliner, the one that I was going to see because I wasn't sure how long he was going to be around anymore, was B.B. King, and his performance was stellar. His RV also was stellar. It was parked down on the side and, you know, kind of roped off so those of us who were fans could not go down there and pester him, but his RV was really nice. The other people who played there who also had their RVs, and we could see these guys come out and, you know, they'd sit around in lawn chairs and chat with each other and so forth. Johnny Lee Hooker and John Mayer, there were, the bill is just massive. And that was a really fun blues festival. I went with some friends. We camped. The artists were camping. It was wonderful music. The weather was great. And it was just a fun experience. It wasn't camping like I had done previously by myself with a cigar box guitar. It was different because there were, you know, thousands of people around and we all had our own little space. But it was fun because we all had something in common. We all shared this appreciation for the blues and we shared our music with each other. Some of us brought our music to listen to. Some people brought guitars and we just sat around and shared food and met people, had fun, listened to some music. It was an awesome experience. And that's what makes those music festivals just so fabulous, because it automatically establishes a baseline for everybody. We all have this in common. We all share this. And then from there, we can start to share even more. And we all appreciate the music that is coming from, you know, Buddy Guy or whoever happens to be on stage. So music festivals are one of those fun camping experiences. And I don't know, honestly, when the first music festival occurred. You could probably go back and say, you know, that some of the big band stuff with John Philip Sousa created music festivals and so forth. But of course, the most famous of all of them is Woodstock, where there was no place for anybody to stay. And so they all just kind of slept wherever. And that classic moment, probably the defining moment of a music festival in American history, was Sunday morning at the crack of dawn. This ripping guitar solo comes out through the crisp New York air of Jimi Hendrix playing the Star Spangled Banner. I am way too young to have been there, but I've seen the videos and I've listened to his solo, and it just had to have been amazing to wake up in your tent or outside under the stars and hear this just wailing guitar to rise and shine to and kind of draw everybody together at the stage. If you were there, or if you lived during that time and knew somebody was there and you want to share that personal experience, please, you know, send that message to me. I'll tell you how at the end of the podcast, but I would love to hear that story. And I'd love to hear any other stories from music festivals that any of you have attended as well. So that's the end of part 4. Baby shark, mommy shark, daddy shark, grandpa shark, lost an arm, lost a leg, CPR, it isn't working, incarnation, baby shark. So here we are finally at the beginning and the end. This is part 5, and this is where I think we can learn something. Music and camping go hand in hand like peanut butter and jam. And there shouldn't be anything stopping us from making music while we are camping. I know what you're thinking. I'm not good at singing. I'm not good at playing the guitar, or I don't own an instrument. You have been listening to the horrible lyrics of historic children's camp songs throughout this podcast. I can guarantee that anything you make at the campsite will be memorable and probably a lot less disturbing than what we have already heard. So go to the thrift store and buy some cheesy little instruments and take them out yourself, give them to kids, just sit around and make something up and just have fun with it, because that's the entire point of camping anyhow, is to have fun. Sit there and make up songs about what you did while you were camping. You never know when one of those things will stick. And your group of friends or your family, whoever you camp with, will come back later, 20, 30 years later, to maybe a shop like mine after renting a teardrop trailer and say, that was such a great memory. I want to recreate that for my own kids. This is where I'm going to say, if you want to share, right? I asked you previously, if you want to share a music festival story, please do so. If you want to share a song you wrote or just the lyrics you wrote, please do so, and you can do that through the Anchor app. Download the Anchor app and just leave me a voice message on the Anchor app, and I would just love to hear what you've come up with. Something I thought would be great would be to, you know, put a song list up that would fit really well with camping. And so I hopped on the internet and started searching. Of course, the very first thing that came up was BuzzFeed, because they make lists for everything. I really think they should stop. Please, BuzzFeed, please stop making lists. And this is actually what kept me from making a song list at all. I found one of their articles said 15 songs to play while pitching a tent. If it takes you 15 songs to pitch a tent, you're doing it wrong. And really, you paid somebody to come up with a list of 15 songs to listen to while you're pitching a tent? All right, that's just ridiculous. I hope you've enjoyed music and camping. I'll probably come back to this topic again. It's a topic that I'm passionate about, and I know many other people are as well. But as an introduction, at least, to the topic, I hope you've enjoyed the Twisted Children's Tunes, and I will see you in the next podcast.
This episode of the Simple Camping Podcast was brought to you by OverlandTrailer.com. Log on to OverlandTrailer.com to see all episodes of this podcast, as well as on iTunes, Google Play, and all the other places you like to find your podcast.
Lark. Nice, Lark. Lark, I will pluck you. I will pluck your head. I will pluck your head and your head and your head.